So the MILA Scatter is the new way to handle subsurface scattering in Maya and Mental Ray. And this is good news because it's much easier to use and it's a lot more flexible. Let's take a look. So I've got a character head here, and right now I have a diffuse reflection assigned to my MILA material. It's just showing us what the diffuse texture map looks like. Now, if I look at the MILA material and I check out the base component, I'll see that there is a scatter here, diffuse scatter. And if I turn that on, I'll get a new scatter node that shows up. The thing is, if we look closely at all these different attributes, this is the same scatter node that has been in Mental Ray forever. This is the fast skin node. So I don't want to use fast skin. I want to use the new MILA scatter material. So I'm going to keep my base layer as a diffuse, and I'm going to start adding new layers on top of it. So I'm going to start by adding my scatter layer, and I'll do it as a weighted layer. And I'll just choose scatter from the menu that pops up. And I'll see this shows up here, and we'll see that the options are very different than the scatter that we choose if we place it on the base. And this scatter works a lot more easily to put together than the previous version. So now that we've assigned this, let's do a quick render and see what the new render looks like. And when the new render pops up, we see that, yeah, subsurface scattering is working. It's just working way too much. We've got something that we can sort of make out the shadow of the nose and the mouth, but we're losing all of our detail. And so we still need to adjust that scale conversion factor that we used on the fast skin. And we use it the exact same way. It makes my object look less scattered the higher the number. It makes my object look more scattered the lower the number. So I can turn this up to a different value. And when I set that new value, that will render and I'll get something that should look more solid. So the new render pops up and I can see that it's very different. It's not as jelly-like as my previous render. We can actually see details on the surface of the object. We can make out the nose and make out the lips. We're getting nice back scattering coming through the back of the ear. And what's really interesting about the MILA scatter node is we can see that all the color swatches in my material are still white. And yet, we're getting red bleed through on the ear, which is something that we wouldn't think would happen. What's happening is these radius numbers are controlling the way the light propagates through our surface. And before, on the fast skin, we had a single radius number that we typed in. All light that penetrated this skin would travel a certain amount. On the MILA scatter, we've separated that light propagation into the three red, green, and blue channels. And this mimics the way actual skin behaves. Red light wavelength is going to travel further through skin. The blue wavelength is going to travel less through the skin. So if we turn these numbers up, we'll get an even more red effect on the surface of our object. And this makes using the MILA scatter to tune our subsurface scattering much easier. And we can see, comparing the new render to the previous render, we get a lot more red in our shadowed areas because I've adjusted the front and the back radius to have a higher red value. And this, again, mimics the way that skin works, which is why we get such a red tone for skin and we don't get a whole lot of blue. So right now I've got my perfectly white with a little bit of red subdermal material, and I do want to assign a texture to it. So I'm going to go into Photoshop so we can see the textures that we're going to be using. I've created this subdermal texture, and the subdermal texture is going to give us a lot of the skin tone colors that we need. The subdermal is going to be much more saturated than the top layer, the surface or diffuse layer. While we see that there are some echoes of the color from the subdermal, the diffuse color is going to be much more white. This is to reflect the fact that the top layer of our skin cells is actually very white. So I'm going to plug that subdermal map in. I've got my MILA scatter node here. I've got my subdermal texture that we just looked at over here. And I'm just going to middle mouse drag this onto the front tint. that will change the look of my material. I don't necessarily need to do it for the back tint. We won't notice a big difference if we do. And when we re-render, we'll see the new texture gives a lot of color to our object. The render shows the updated subdermal texture, and we're getting something that looks a lot more like regular skin. And when we do apply this texture, we start to see exactly how exaggerated the scatter is looking right now. So I could go in and start playing around with my scale conversion node, but we are not going to use the scatter as our top layer. If we think about it, subsurface scattering, we want the scattering to be happening under the surface. And because the MILA shader is a layered shader, we're going to put another layer on top of it. I'm going to add a layer to my MILA material, and I'm going to use a weighted layer and diffuse reflection. That'll pop up on top. And this diffuse reflection, if I render it right now, would give me a pure gray material. Not very interesting. What I'm going to do with this diffuse material is I'm going to plug my diffuse texture in there, and that is going to blend between the scatter and the diffuse to give me more of the skin tone that I'm looking for. So I'll take my diffuse texture and I'll just middle mouse drag it onto the color here. And now my texture is plugged in. And if I re-render, it'll give me a 100% flat diffuse reflection. It'll look identical to this initial render. So instead, I want to combine it with my subsurface scattering. To do that, because this is a weighted layer, all I need to do to adjust the opacity of the entire layer is to just change the weight. So I'm going to lower the weight on that layer to 0.5, so it'll be half scatter, half diffuse reflection, and then I'll give that a render. And when it finishes rendering, if I compare it to my previous one, I'll see that the previous scatter node is very, very jelly-like. We can see through it very clearly. With 50% of my diffuse laying on top of it, suddenly I have something that feels a lot more solid. But if I compare it to the original diffuse, this solid texture here, I'm getting all sorts of gray shadows. Things look very hard. It looks very much like a Lambert material. With the scatter applied, things look soft and the shadows are warmed up. We're getting a lot more red in there. And we're also getting the back scatter effects. This allows me to also plug in my bump map. So in order to attach the bump map, I do need to go to utilities and find a bump 2D node and bring this in here. And I have my bump map texture here, and I'm just going to connect that to the bump 2D node. And because it's a tangent space normal, obviously I switched this. And now I'm going to plug this bump map into the bump channel on my diffuse reflection. So just middle mouse drag. And now when I render, I'll get the bump node plugged into the rest of the head. And when the render is finished and the bump map is applied, we're probably not going to see a lot of effect from the bump map. And some of this is because of the way the scatter node works. Because the scatter node is a subsurface scatter node, a bump map is not going to affect it because a bump map affects the surface. And of course, the scatter is subsurface. So we can plug in bump map on our diffuse reflection, but generally it's not going to start showing up until we start adding things like specular reflections. So since the bump map won't work so well without specularity, let's add a specular layer into this mix. And we can do either a weighted layer or a Fresnel layer. I'm going to do a weighted layer just to keep things simple. And I'm going to use a glossy reflection. And so this is going to be applied over the top of my object. And if I leave it at 100% opaque with a color of white, it's going to look pretty much like chrome. So I'm going to reduce the opacity significantly, and I'm going to plug my bump map in here. And when we render, we're going to get something that looks awfully shiny, but at the same time, it's going to show more of the surface detail of the skin. So indeed, the model looks extremely shiny, as if coated in oil. So what we want to do here is we want to change the weight down pretty significantly. And this will just be an overall shininess layer, just a little bit of the skin's natural oils. And we definitely want to raise the roughness on this material because we don't want this to actually reflect anything. We want it to be just shiny and not reflective. And we can compare it to before, and we'll see that it just adds a little bit to the skin. And when things start animating, the character starts moving around, this is going to add to the surface a lot. So let's start adding more specularity. Now I'm going to add a Fresnel layer, another glossy reflection layer. And this one, we want to be pretty shiny. So I've got my new glossy reflection. I've plugged my bump map in there. And I can do a render just to see what it looks like so I can see what the starting material is going to be. And we can see that we're getting a lot of specularity around the edges. We're also getting some really hot highlights where the bump map is picking up some of that detail. One thing that we can do is we can up the roughness so that we're not getting any really, really shiny stuff. And we can also up the IOR. And by upping the IOR, we'll make the reflection stronger, but it's also going to be more focused. And we can lower the weight on that channel. And when we render, we'll end up with something that is going to be a little bit more focused around the edges, but it's also going to be much less opaque. And the end result, we get a more broad specular, and it's also less focused around the edges, so it's not creating those really big bright white highlights. Now, let's talk about adding a displacement map. Generally, because of the way the subsurface scatter node works, it can be preferable to add a displacement to our model so that even though the subsurface won't show surface detail, the entire model is going to be displaced, so we can't help but get more high resolution detail. So I'm going to click on the shading group node that's the parent of the MILA material, and I'm going to plug in a displacement into this displacement mat channel. And so I've got my displacement here, a black and white texture, and when I'm using this black and white texture, we want to turn on alpha as luminance. That'll usually give us a better result. I've plugged that into the displacement, and now I can just middle mouse drag that onto the displacement material. And to view this, it's a lot easier to view it if we're doing a before after on just a regular diffuse layer. Now, when we're using displacement and mental ray, there's one more thing that we're usually going to want to check. We want to select our model and go to the Windows menu and then Rendering Editors and then Mental Ray. We're looking for this, the Approximation Editor. And the Approximation Editor allows us to adjust the displacement and the subdivision tessellation on our object. This basically tells Maya how you want it subdivide for the displacement when you actually do render. So I'm just going to create here, and you can use whatever preset we want. Fine view, high quality works fine. And I can do the same thing for subdivisions, and in this case, spatial. And I'll re-render. This will generally make the render take longer as well because it's subdividing the mesh more. It's going to give us a better quality result. However, we will see the renders, anytime we're using displacement, are going to take much, much longer than they otherwise would. So now I render, and we can see the displacement's effect. We can compare it before and after. We can see that it has a pretty significant effect on the surface. Now, when we're using displacement and mental ray, there's one more thing that we're usually going to want to check. We want to select our model and go to the Windows menu and then Rendering Editors and then Mental Ray. We're looking for this, the Approximation Editor. And the Approximation Editor allows us to adjust the displacement and the subdivision tessellation on our object. This basically tells Maya how you want it subdivide for the displacement when you actually do render. So I'm just going to create here, and you can use whatever preset we want. Fine view, high quality works fine. I could do the same thing for subdivisions, and in this case, spatial is the one I usually work. And I'll re-render. This will generally make the render take longer as well because it's subdividing the mesh more. It's going to give us a better quality result. However, we will see the renders, anytime we're using displacement, are going to take much, much longer than they otherwise would. So with those settings turned on, you should get a better result out of your displacement map. And now I can re-enable all the other layers, so the scatter layer and my reflection layers. And the displacement will now affect all of those layers. So I should get a much more accurate looking representation of my model. All right, so now we have the displacement enabled on top of the rest of the mesh. And if we go back to this point here where we can see, we're not seeing a lot of bump mapping on this one because the subsurface hides it. And by turning on the displacement, we end up with a surface that works pretty well. And compared to the original where we have the displacement and just the diffuse texture, we get something that looks a lot more natural and a lot more interesting.